Good morning, good morning. I apologize. Are we ready to go? Yeah, okay, good. Sorry, I had to run around and grab a few things that I had forgotten to grab on the way in. Anyways, happy Sabbath. Good to see you all. It's time for announcements. Let's see. Okay, some of you know that once a quarter we do communion service, so please prepare yourselves this week. We will be having communion service next week. Take some time to introspect and really recommit to the Lord and come ready next Sabbath for communion service. We are announcing a few, this is the first reading of a few transfers leaving CPC. Chantel Moreau going to New Life, Philippe Stenier going to College Church, South Lancaster. Interesting. Joining us is Angus Batson and Veronica Martin Batson, and they're coming in from Ajax Community. So if you see them around, please introduce yourselves. Make sure that they feel welcome and that they're part of our family here at CPC. Wanted to announce that the Pathfinders Club is having a very special event. Now, this is going to benefit the adults, I think, more than the kids. The kids, well, you know, they always have fun wherever they go. They always have, you know, games and are able to be distracted and things like that. But this is your opportunity for a date night. So, gentlemen, start making your plans. All right, start making your plans to take the sweetheart and take her out for a nice time. Contact Pathfinders, make all the arrangements, call ahead, make the reservations, you know, because you need to take your sweetheart out and just have some time alone. Or, you know, if budget does not allow, a movie night in would be nice. But Pathfinders is offering you this service. They're going to have an event called Time Out. They're going to have games, snacks, face painting, all sorts of fun stuff to entertain your kids for a couple of hours. Let me see. The date is April 7th, so it's coming up really fast. And this is a great opportunity to support the club, help them raise funds for their trip, and also give you guys a break, right? Because the timeout is mostly for you guys, more than the kids. The kids are going to go enjoy themselves, but this is a great opportunity to support the club and also, benefit your family as well. So, so we have received a lot of eclipse glasses. Now, we don't recommend that you look at the event without some sort of protection, right? And thanks to Pastor Amarim, I believe he was able to gift us just a bunch of these glasses. They are at the welcome desk, so please, if you want to avail yourself of a pair so that you can participate in this celestial event, we do have the glasses back there, and you're welcome to have it. All right. CPC. Right. In Kingsway. As many of you know, we haven't seen Kingsway all too much around here. But we are making strides in bringing them back into our family here. One of the things that we're doing is having a joint Vespers. That's going to be on April 5th. At 7 p.m. So please come support. Kingsway know that we love them. They're part of our family, and we'll worship and bring in the Sabbath together. Amen? All right. MindFit. How many of you guys know what's going on with MindFit? Great. I see a few hands. This is a ministry that I believe is incredibly important right now. There's a lot of people out there that are suffering with emotional issues and depression and all sorts of things that they keep quiet, and they don't know exactly what to do, how to handle it, how to process. And sometimes most of the time, it's a very lonely experience, right? Well, we here at College Park recognize that we don't want you to just be healthy spiritually, but mentally and physically as well. And so we're putting on this MindFit series. It's going to be a little bit of a hybrid thing, but we are meeting in person downstairs. And please, we invite you to invite your neighbors. Tell people about it. We have information, invitation cards, and something that we'll be collecting around the offering time is this commitment to attend. And so we need your information on here. Please put it into the offering plate when the deacons pass by to let us know, right? To let us know you're going to be here, and we can make arrangements, make sure that we have enough space and we're setting up right for it. We're also giving these prayer cards. Now, here's the thing. Because we know that emotional and mental issues, psychological issues, and depression and things like that are so prevalent, we know people in our own lives. And the crucial thing is for us to pray for them. Pray for them to come to the meetings. Pray for them that the Lord bring a breakthrough in their life. And so we have these prayer cards that we'd like for you guys to use. Put down the names of the people that you want to pray for to benefit from this program and to just receive that breakthrough from the Lord. We also have this flyer that we would love for you to hang and hand out. Now, I don't think we have billions of flyers that you could just scatter willy-nilly, as they say, right? But what we want you to do is make a connection with somebody. Give this to somebody you know and that knows you. And pray with them and let them know that there's this service that we are going to be putting on that may help them, right? And right now we can use all the help that we can get, right? So there is a QR code, and we'd like for you to scan it and do the registration and everything and get more information as well. We're also going to play a quick video right after I'm done with announcements regarding this. But I want to put that out there to make sure that you guys are aware this is coming up really fast, so we kind of have to move really quick. It's only a few days that's going to be going on from, I believe, Thursday, Friday, and Sabbath. And so we really want you, not just for attendance, we want you guys to benefit. And I know that I'll be there, pastors will be there, we're gonna benefit from this too, I gotta say. So please make sure that you leave with some of these flyers at the very least, so that you can share them with others. I also wanted to make a quick announcement. I'm not sure if there's a slide for it.
Hey, Alex Rodriguez here, Associate Speaker at the Voice of Prophecy. Just wanted to take a couple of minutes to thank you again for partnering with us and to invite you to pray and invite others to attend the MindFit event. Here's the reality. There's 8 billion people in the world, and we are told that 1 in 8 are struggling with mental illness. That's a staggering 1 billion people. And in the USA, the numbers are worse, 1 in 5. That means that we're all touched in one way or another by mental illness. This is your next-door neighbor, work colleague, high school friend, family member, or maybe even you. Through MindFit, you have an opportunity to make a real difference in people's lives. And how better to invite people to your church than to bring them to an event that is completely non-threatening and meets the real needs of the struggles they are facing each and every day? Here's what I want you to do. Take your MindFit prayer card and ask God to tell you who to write down on the list. Then write the names of at least 5 people you think would benefit from attending this program. Each day, pray diligently for the people on your list, asking God to give you an opportunity to invite them. Then, with the courage that God will give you, take them an invitation and personally hand it to them. Statistics reveal that the most effective marketing plan is through personal invitation. I'm looking forward to hearing the stories of how God blessed you and your church through your faithful prayer and diligence. Know that we are praying for you, your community, and the MindFit event.
Doesn't that seem awesome, guys? So please make sure that you have some people you're praying for, that you take some invitations, and please let your neighbors know. We're not going to put so much pressure on them where we want to convert them right there and then. We're trying to provide a service to the community because we know it's really needed. And God, He cares about our mental state as well, right? Speaking of prayer, I wanted to announce, sadly, that one of our longtime members, he was at Pioneer, passed away, Roger Pollock. Some of you may know him. Passed away just this week, I believe it was. We got notification. And so our condolences go out to the family. And please reach out to them, especially if you have a connection with them, if you know them. Let them know that we're here for them, that we're praying for them. So that's it for my announcements. And have a good Sabbath.
Amen. Thank you, Roslyn. Good morning, church, and welcome to service at College Park Church. It is good to see so many of you here on this special Sabbath. I would like to especially thank Kingsway Nursery for gifting us these beautiful flowers that you are seeing here that are adorning our stage today. Thank you. You always make special events even more special here at College Park Church. At the end of the service, you are welcome to take one of these. And Kingsway Nursery has requested that you share these with maybe a neighbor or someone in your community. Maybe give them the flowers first and then that card. They will not be able to say no, so that would be a nice way to connect with people with flowers. As you all are aware, the world is celebrating, observing Good Friday, Easter weekend this weekend, and one of the most Googled searches is, why did Jesus die, apparently? And while there could be many reasons that we can give for the purpose of Christ's death on the cross, one thing that struck me and that I have not heard so far. I found in one of my favorite, all-time favorite books, The Desire of Ages, in the chapter called Calvary, where Mrs. White says that he was earning his right to become our advocate in the Father's presence. Jesus was earning his right to become the advocate of men in the Father's presence. So even while they're on the cross, he was thinking of us. So for our call to worship, I would like to read this passage from the chapter Calvary. While the soldiers were doing their fearful work, Jesus prayed for his enemies. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That prayer of Christ for his enemies embraced the world. It took in every sinner that had lived or should live from the beginning of the world to the end of time. Upon all rests the guilt of crucifying the Son of God. To all, forgiveness is freely offered. Whoever will may have peace with God and inherit eternal life. Amen. Shall we close our eyes for prayer? Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your only begotten Son to die on the cross for us so that we may be saved. Thank you for preparing a place for us so we may be united in you at the end of our life and the end of our time. I pray in your precious name. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, Church. As our head elder said this morning, we are celebrating something special this weekend. We are reminded that God came to this world and he died on a cross for us. Let's all sing praises to our King this morning because he deserves nothing but everything from us.
Rejected and alone. Amen. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 14, it says that if Jesus did not rise, our preaching would be in vain. Our hope would be in vain. We would be like the most pitied of men, or the most pitiful of men. But praise the Lord that he did rise. He came to die, and a lot of people don't understand that. Why did your God die? But he came to die, and we rejoice in that today. Because he lives, because he rose from the grave, we have the hope, and we can face tomorrow.
Please stand and join us as we sing our last song.
Okay. I'm going to invite all my young friends to come up front. I'm going to be doing the children's story.
Hey. Time is in.
Hooray!
All right. Come on up, guys. Don't be shy. Come sit over here. We'll have a good story. Hey, how are you? Good to see you. Welcome, welcome. Hello. Come on up. Thank you. Happy Sabbath. Come on up. Come on up. Good to see you. Have a seat. All right. How are you guys? Good. It looks like you guys had breakfast. I hear some enthusiasm in your voice. No? You're tired? Oh, I'm sorry to hear it. Come on up. Come on up. Great. What season are we in? Anybody know? What season are we in?
I eat breakfast.
What is it?
I eat breakfast.
Oh, you had breakfast. Oh, yes. Good. I'm so glad.
It's spring.
It's spring. How many of you, by a show of hands, how many of you love summertime? How many of you love wintertime? Oh, how many of you really love spring? Isn't spring awesome? Yes. I know. This weather's been horrible. What is going on? It's like our seasons are flipped, but I can't wait for summer. By a show of hands, how many of you have gone camping? Yeah, a few hands. How many of you would love to go camping? Yeah, it's exciting. You know, I still remember the first time I went camping. I was a little boy, maybe 6 or 7. I can't remember exactly. But it was the first time I was in a boat. Yeah. We went to Wisconsin Dells. I don't know if you know that, but I grew up in the U.S. and in Illinois. Everybody around the Chicago area, we all go to Wisconsin Dells for camping. I don't know why, but that seems to be the mecca camping for Chicago people. So we went up there. It was my first time, and my dad's great idea. He's like, let's go boating. I'd never been boating. So we went to the dock, and they gave me this really huge life jacket, right? And it was like choking me. I was like, I could barely see. I couldn't even turn my neck. I was like, okay, this is fun. I was walking around like this, all funny. We got into the boat. And once we got into the boat, I was like a little like unsteady, right? Because I was like, I'd never been on a boat. And if you rock around too much on a boat, it starts to wobble like this, right? Well, we start cruising in the river. And then my uncles join us because they were with us. They went camping with us. And they start going. And my uncles were younger and a little bit immature. And they started going zoom, zoom. And then our little boat, where me and my parents were, it started rocking. I'm like, oh, Lord, what are we going to do? Oh, this is not feeling good. My stomach is getting kind of queasy. But they kept doing it. They kept doing it. And one of the times they zoomed by, they created this huge wave. And guess what happened? Guess what happened?
It tipped over.
That's right. Our little boat flipped over. Now, you got to remember, I was only like 6 or 7. I was kind of young. How many of you guys are 6 and how many of you are 7? 6? 7? Okay. You're 5? I was just a little bit older. Well, when the big wave came by, my parents saw right away what was going to happen, and they both jumped. But I was only 6 or 7, and I panicked, and I said, what is going on? And all of a sudden, I was upside down under the water. Because I remained sitting. I was like, whoop, and just flipped. Now, remember I was wearing that life jacket? Well, that life jacket was kind of trying to push me up out of the water, but the boat was over me. And I was like, looking around, and I couldn't see anything. The water was really dark, and it was black, and I couldn't see anything. And I was like, all I could hear is voices, and I could hear my mom in the background. And my dad's trying to get under the boat, trying to get, and he's trying to pull me under the water, trying to pull me under the water, and he couldn't. I was like, bloop, bloop, right? Because the life jacket was trying to pull me up, trying to keep me safe, but it was making me stay stuck under the boat. Well, my dad finally, I don't know, the angels were helping him, and he got this superhuman strength, and he went and he grabbed my life jacket and boop, all the way down, and then boop, all the way up, I pop up. Woo! Man, that took it out of me. And so I was safe, praise God. Yeah. I know. I couldn't believe it. God was so good, he saved my life. Not only that, but my dad risked his life to make sure that I can get out from underneath. I know it's so crazy, right? Getting stuck under the boat and then... What weekend is this? Yeah, what are we celebrating this weekend? Do you guys know? Easter. I know. So we're celebrating Easter. Did you have a question?
Why is the cross right there?
Oh, well, that represents royalty and how Jesus is king and how he was pure. That's why it's on the cross. Did you know that? Okay, we'll talk some more later, okay? Yeah, I can tell you the rest of the story then. Well, this weekend reminds me of that very moment. You see, we are all sinners. Did you guys know that? How many of you have ever done a bad thing? I won't tell your parents. Okay, all right, so I'm glad you're honest. Thank you very much for being honest. But you know what? That's called sin. And sin is a bad thing because sin takes us away from God. And we're so far from God because we sin. But someone came into this darkness, into this place. And what's his name? Jesus. Jesus came into this sinful world to do what? To save us. Yeah. Okay, we'll talk somewhere later. Okay, buddy? So Jesus came down to save us. He did what my dad was trying to do. He was trying to pull me out from underneath, from being trapped in the darkness of the waters. And so Jesus has come down to do that for all of us. Isn't that amazing? Yeah. Jesus is trying to save us. Oh, I think that's just amazing. You know, I have something for you. Yeah, I've got something for you guys. I wanted to give you guys a couple texts that I found that are so awesome because it tells us about how much God loves us. So the first one is Romans 5:8. Listen carefully, okay? It says, God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were yet sinners. You see, we're kind of trapped down here in this earth, and this earth is full of sin and darkness, but he came down to take us out. Yeah, you're going to get one of these. And the second verse I'd like to share is John 14:6. It says, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. That means if we follow Jesus, we are going to follow him to life. Isn't that amazing, guys? Oh. So what do you guys think of my artwork? Not bad, right? I still got it. I can still color. All right. So I'm going to give each and every one of you one of these. And if you need more to give to a friend, they're going to be in the back. All right. So let's close with prayer. All right. Close your eyes with me. Fold your little hands. Let's pray to Jesus. Dear Jesus, thank you so much. Thank you for your love. Thank you for caring so much about us and for us. Even while we are sinners, you still love us so very much. And we pray that you forgive us and that you help us, Lord, to always follow you to eternity. So please save us. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. All right, guys. Come and get one of these, and then you can go back to your seats. All right. Oh, excuse me. All right, so today, our the offering schedule is for your local budget. As you know, whatever you put into the offering plate is for blessing the budget of the church, right? And it helps us, it funds us, and it helps us do all sorts of projects and all sorts of things to further the gospel, right? So I'm going to ask the deacons to step forward, and we'll pray as the video goes. And if you have those invitation cards, please let them know and then drop it into the offering plate. All right. All right, let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. The sun is shining and is warming our hearts, and we're enjoying our Sabbath day with you, but we're also reflecting on the fact that you have come. You have died for us. You have sacrificed everything. You've given your life for us. And you don't require our life in return as a sacrifice in the sense that we need to die. You're asking us to share our life with you and allow you to do great things. And Lord, in that we share. We share the blessings that you've given us financially, Lord. And we pray that you bless it, that it may go forth and bless this world and provide funding for all sorts of projects that will further the kingdom. And Lord, whatever remains in our pocket, Lord, we pray that it may cover our needs. And we thank you, Lord, for blessing us. We thank you for so much. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen.
In 1857, David Livingstone was invited to receive a tribute and speak to students at Cambridge University in England. He had left behind a prosperous life in Europe to preach the gospel across Africa. As he stood in front of the students, he was just a thin, slender man who had been stricken 31 times by deadly African fevers and had one of his arms resting in a sling after an encounter with a lion. England celebrated him as a hero due to his life of self-denial and sacrifice. But now, in front of those attentive students, Livingstone offered his perspective on sacrifice. "People talk of the sacrifice I have made in spending so much of my life in Africa. Can that be called a sacrifice which is simply paid back as a small part of a great debt owing to our God, which we can never repay? Is that a sacrifice which brings its own blessed reward in healthful activity, the consciousness of doing good, peace of mind, and a bright hope of a glorious destiny hereafter? Away with the word in such a view and with such a thought. I never made a sacrifice. Of this we ought not to talk when we remember the great sacrifice which he made who left his Father's throne on high to give himself for us." Words like these remind us that the true sacrificial offering came from Calvary. Every offering we give to the cause of God is infinitely less than what we receive from the gift of the cross. However, in our sphere, we are called to offer a sacrificial offering to God. This means that when determining the proportion of our income that we give as regular offering, we must select a percentage that challenges us to trust in God's care and blessings. This is one of the reasons God decided that while the tithe would be 10% of our income, it is for the worshiper to set the percentage of their income to be given as a regular offering. Ellen G. White says that in the Bible system of tithes and offerings, the amounts paid by different persons will, of course, vary greatly since they are proportioned to the income. Therefore, she also says, "How much more eager will every faithful steward be to enlarge the proportion of gifts to be placed in the Lord's treasure house? Does the proportion or percentage of your income given as offering genuinely represent a sacrifice? Is it leading you to trust Him more and to live by faith? Is it not time for you to enlarge that percentage so that you may learn how to live by faith? The time is rapidly coming when all that is not dedicated to God and His cause will be lost forever. Let us now invest all we can while there is still time and learn how to live by faith, trusting that He is still able to provide for us. As we return our tithe and promise, which is our regular and systematic offering, may we put our desires last and God first.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. I invite you all to kneel with me as possible, for those of you who are able to do so, at this point in time as we seek the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we adore Thee. We thank You for waking us up this morning, and You saw it fit to clothe us in our right minds. You provided the oxygen we needed. You animated us, Father, and we are able to come into Your presence and to worship You. We thank You that You created us in Your own image. And after we sinned, Father, You redeemed us. And today we come and we reflect not only upon the Sabbath as a means of creation, but as a means of redemption. We thank You for Your provision, Father, and we are aware that as we continue to sojourn here on earth, that there be many more challenges, there be obstacles, there be difficult times. But we are confident that the God who created us and redeemed us is able to see us through. So, Father, this morning I put before You those of us who are mourning the loss of loved ones. I pray, Father, that You may be to us a wonderful counselor, that You may comfort, and that You may, Father, lift up the cross once more before us so that we can see that there is indeed hope, that we will not sorrow as those who have no hope, knowing that one day we'll be reunited with our loved ones. Father, I want to pray for those who are having challenges and difficult situations in their marriages. Father, I pray that You may intervene and You may be to them as well a counselor, one who will be able to guide and to direct the thoughts and the affairs of couples. For those who are contemplating marriage, Father, I pray that they may seek You first and that You'll be able to lead them in the way in which they should go. Father, for those who are having challenges financially, I pray, Father, that You'll be to them their financial counselor, that You will guide them in their affairs, in the way in which they manage their resources. Father, I pray that today that Your people will put You first, that they will seek You, and everything else that they desire will be added thereafter. Father, I pray for children who are in school, those who are in universities, elementary or high. I pray, Father, as they pursue their education and their academic studies, that they will put You first and that You'll be able to lead and to direct their paths. Indeed, You have said that Your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And Father, as we sojourn here on earth and as You direct our affairs and as You speak to us through Your Holy Spirit, I pray, Lord, that we will be obedient. Father, I want to put before You this morning those who are visiting, maybe for the first time, maybe they are repeat visitors. Father, I pray that You may speak to their hearts through the message this morning. Therefore, I pray, Father, that as Your manservant, Pastor Godsoe, take his stand this morning, that You may hide him behind, Lord, a veil. The voice that they will hear will not be his, but be that coming straight from the throne of grace. Father, I pray that Your Holy Spirit will have His own way today. It will move up and down through the pews. It will touch the hearts of every man, every woman, and every boy, and every girl. Father, I pray today that everyone who comes into Your presence to worship You this morning will receive a message, will leave rejoicing, knowing that even though they're going through trying times, Father, there may be bills to be paid. There may be diagnoses that have been received. There may be disappointment that they have faced in the course of the week. And as You said in Your word, weeping we may enjoy for the night, but joy indeed cometh in the morning. So I pray, Father, at the end of this service, that everyone will leave here rejoicing, giving God the honor, the glory, and the praise, as we ask this all in Jesus' name.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, Church. Today's reading will be a responsive reading. You can find number 733 at the back of your hymnal. I will start, and may the congregation please follow. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? To attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with the suffering, like one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised and we esteemed him not. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughterer, and as a sheep before his shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death. Though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. After the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear his iniquities. May God bless this reading.
Amen. Thank you, Sandy. Sandy is our hardworking church secretary who also often steps in for us to sing and do a whole bunch of other things as well. So thank you. We appreciate that. It's a beautiful song. I don't know the Spanish part. I only do English. But I like that line where it says, he chose, you know, he chose to walk. And that's really what we celebrate this weekend. So thank you for bringing that message to us, which fits so appropriately with what we're doing. Just wanted to mention the funeral service for Mr. Pollock, I believe, is on Wednesday, I think at 11 o'clock, is that right? 11 o'clock, so if you knew that family and want to be here for the service, it's right here at College Park Church at 11 o'clock on Wednesday, this coming Wednesday. Happy sunny Sabbath morning to you. It's a nice day outside, nice day to be here. Glad that you're here. Some people are joining us virtually at Kingsway Pioneer Home, but we're especially glad for those of you that are here. It's nice to see your faces and hope that you're having a good Sabbath. Pastor Martin, I don't know where he is, but I would love to take him for a boat ride sometime. There, you're right there. Yes, I would love, but I have to tell you, I did actually sink a powerboat one time, so I don't know. Think about it. Wear your oversized life jacket if you ever come with me. But thank you for that story too. That was invigorating. I was almost tired just sitting there listening to it by the end. So that was, I mean, tired with all the energy. That was good. All right. Well, you know, even though the statistics are daunting, nevertheless, we can be thankful for the good news. And that is, the good news is that the number of children worldwide who died before their fifth birthday actually reached a historic low in 2022. According to a United Nations report that was just released a couple of weeks ago by UNICEF, in fact, the global under five mortality rate declined by 51% since the year 2000. And both the under five mortality rate and the actual number of deaths, under five deaths, actually has fallen by more than half since 1990, so a little over 30 years, it's fallen by half. So that's good, and yet as encouraging as all of that is, the picture, don't be misled, the picture is still very grim. It seems that circumstances in our world are such that, to be very blunt, many children are born basically to die, merely born to die. So what is this historically low number of children who died before their fifth birthday in 2022? You know what the number is? It's a mere, and I say that facetiously, it's a mere 4.9 million a year. 4.9 million. And of course, there are many factors that contribute to this tragedy. The impact of extreme food shortage and hunger, along with increased war and conflict in several parts of the world, those things certainly play a role in so many children in the world not surviving. But along with that, this massive loss of young life is actually primarily due to preventable and treatable causes, like preterm birth complications around the time of birth and basically diseases. Main ones being pneumonia, diarrhea, and malaria. In fact, the leading causes of post-neonatal death are acute respiratory infections, diarrhea, and malaria. That's what takes out most of the children of the world. And many of these 4.9 million children die in the very first days after birth, nearly half of the victims being newborns. On top of this, just to make the picture a little more grim, the lives of an additional 2.1 million children and youth, who they consider those ages 5 to 24, they are also cut short in 2022. So in 1 year, that's how many people, 24 years of age and younger, that we lose. And this is a good number compared to how it's been for decades. Maybe to break this down just a little bit more specifically, 2.3 million children a year die during their first month of life. And then another 2.6 million die between the ages of 1 and 59 months. In other words, from the time when they're 1 month old to up to the point where they're going to turn 5. And then if we step back and look at a little bit longer term, bigger picture on this, between 2000 and 2022, so since the beginning of this millennium, our world, how many children has our world lost? 221 million children, adolescents, and youth. What's that like? 221 million, what does that mean? That's nearly the entire population of the sixth largest country in the world by population, Nigeria. That means in that period of time, we lost like Nigeria, just in our young people. And of those 221 million who are lost through the first 23 years of this millennium, 162 million of those children were younger than the age of 5, which, again, to put that in perspective, is almost equal to the population of the eighth most populous country in our world, and that's Bangladesh. So children under 5, 23 years, it's like country of Bangladesh, just gone. 72 million of those children died before they reached the age of 1 month, and 91 million died between the ages of 1 month and 59 months. And then beyond that, we're not quite done. We could also note that nearly 53 million stillbirths took place between 2000 and 2021. And stillbirths are deaths which are often not included in the statistics or the data. They're often not reported or way underreported. So if we're talking about the loss of life of children, it's even more grim. So, as encouraging and hopeful as the trends are, we can see there's still a very long road ahead of us as a species on this planet to end all of the preventable child and youth deaths. This is a reality of our world. And yet I think even in places and situations in the world where the odds are anything but great for children to be able to survive, I expect that it's true that even there, I think the natural hope of us humans, the natural hope of their parents and their siblings and the communities that they're in, the natural hope is that those who are born will live. I mean, we all should realize that sooner or later we're all gonna die at some point, sooner or later, but our focus is on, and our focus should be on, survival. Is there anyone who would bring a child into this world for no other reason than that the child could someday die? I certainly hope not. Unfortunately, many children and pregnancies here in this part of our world, and probably all over the world, many children are not wanted. They're unwanted. But at least those who decide to abort the lives of their babies do so for the vast majority of the time before their babies are born. This idea of being born just to die, it should be very unsettling to us. something that we can't, something that we shouldn't get comfortable with. It's something that seems pointless, right? Why be born just to die? Now, with many animals, it's a different story, right? At least from our perspective as humans. The sole purpose of the existence of many animals is simply their death. They're bred and they're raised simply so that they can be killed to provide us with food to eat or other products we want to use. And so their whole life is geared toward preparing them to get to the point where they're ready to die as soon as possible. Not die as soon as possible, but ready to die as soon as possible. That's animals. That's maybe one thing for animals. But when it comes to human beings, it's different, because people aren't supposed to be born just to die, which is kind of why that whole issue of cloning should, and you know, where that could possibly go in regard to humans, should make us uneasy, right? Like, should we be producing people just so we got some spare parts? I mean, that's a scary thing to think about, right? And I guess that's a big part of what makes his life and his death so extraordinary, so unique, and frankly, so disturbing, really. Because Jesus Christ, as has already been mentioned several times in this service, Jesus Christ was actually born to die. It's crazy. Yes, his life was important. During his life, he taught important things. He modeled a perfect life and character. He helped people. He healed people. He gave hope. He gave life. But from before his birth, the focus was always on his death. Everything he did in life was moving towards this point of his death. All that he did found its ultimate meaning and significance in his death. Christ, the perfect Son of God, came here to live as a human. Why? So that he could die as the Lamb of God. And why is it so important that he die? Well, it's the only way to fulfill his mission of being the Savior for a planet of people obsessed with sin. His role was made very clear even before his birth. In Matthew 1:21, we read of an angel telling Joseph that the boy to be born to Mary was to be named Jesus. Why? Because he will save his people from their sins. And then at the time of his birth, Luke 2:11 records how an angel told a group of shepherds the great news that a Savior has been born to you, born to die. Because you see, this universe operates on God's principles, his principles of truth and love and right and justice. That's how it's set up. And it's just a reality in that setting that sin leads to, and sin actually deserves death. That's what we who have gotten ourselves mucked up with sin, that's what we need to be saved from, the death that we're heading to. Because of his love for us, God wants to forgive us for our sins, but justice says that in order to maintain this harmony and happiness that God's laws bring to our universe, to our existence, the penalty for sin must be paid. Hebrews 8:22 says that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. That's what all those animal sacrifices back in the time of the Old Testament were about. All of those animals that were born just to die, raised so that they could hopefully be a perfect sacrifice. They were intended to constantly remind people that the price for sin would one day have to be permanently paid. God's forgiveness came at an unthinkable price, and yet he was willingly able to foot the bill, personally foot the bill for us. And so Jesus came as our Savior. He was born to shed his blood and die in our place. That's why he was called the Lamb of God. He was the true, perfect sacrifice that all those millions and millions of animals that were sacrificed through the years, they were all pointing to him. And the only way that he could save us from having to pay for our own sin with our own lives, the only way that he could provide that forgiveness was through his death. Born to die. Born to die. We've just finished another Good Friday holiday, right? We somehow turn it into a holiday. Get a long weekend, a break. Lots of people are gone because we're taking a break. And that's okay. Probably not the main reason why Jesus died, just so we could have a day off from work and school. But this time of the year is supposed to be a time for Christians, and hopefully not just for Christians, hopefully for others as well, to especially remember the significance and the meaning of this greatest sacrifice, a time for us to ponder the death of Christ. Is it important? Definitely. G. Curtis Jones tells of how an English writer once said that every man struggling to succeed in the literary world should write with an eye on the far-off island where Robert Louis Stevenson lived. And then Jones made an application for Christians from that. And he said, so through the continuing centuries, all who have sought salvation have kept their minds and hearts focused on Calvary, like an eye on Calvary. And he said, there is more here than we can comprehend, but we can understand enough to know that we have been bought with a price. And Jones was right. I don't think any of us are ever going to be able to completely understand and probably never completely fully like we should appreciate the full significance of Jesus Christ's death for us. So does that mean there's really no sense bothering to spend much time thinking about it? No, I would say just the opposite. Because there's so much meaning in what happened on the cross on Calvary, we need to keep pondering that with a sense of awe and amazement, that precious price that Christ paid. And if you've never really heard that story, or maybe you've never really taken it seriously and personally, this is an opportunity for me to encourage you to look into it. And if you choose to do that, prepare yourself for it to have a powerful impact on your life. But what about all you Christians who know the story so well? You know, which is probably a majority of people that are hearing me right now. What about you? I mean, come on, over the years you've heard it, right? You've read it. You've read about it. You've heard how many sermons on it over the years? I mean, you've heard songs about it, you've sung songs about it, you've seen it acted out, you know it, right? And yeah, you believe it. Yeah, you're thankful for what Jesus did, but the truth is, let's face it, it's become kind of common, right? Isn't that true? And yeah, you're thankful. I'll have to admit, it's a challenge to stand here and know what more to say to you who may already be so familiar with the story. Here's the Easter sermon again. What do I say? What would it take to make you look at it again with fresh wonder? Could I come up with words so eloquent that you would be enraptured to listen to them? Not likely. Thank you, I think, Pastor Martin. What would it take? I guess it would take a choice. It really comes down to your choice right now to be willing to take this time to reflect on the relevance of our Savior's sacrifice. You're here. You can be zoned out. You can be thinking about what you're going to eat for lunch. Shouldn't have said that. Or you can choose to think about this right now, and I invite you to do that. I simply want to present for your consideration today the death of Jesus Christ. And whether it's the first time or the whatever time, fill in the blank, I appeal to you to ponder and ponder again what his death means to you. You know, I came across this, I'm ahead of myself, or somebody's ahead of me. I came across a little outline I'd like to use to briefly review Christ's death with you today. And it's not something that I made up. I did write the sermon. It's not somebody else's sermon. But I found this outline that I thought was kind of intriguing to me because it looks at the death from seven perspectives, each one conveniently beginning with the letter P. So I just want to use that to review this story today. So we're going to look at the promise, we're going to look at the prophecy, we're going to look at the pain, we're going to look at the place of our Lord's death, and then we'll consider the person and the power and the pardon in his death. And I know some of you are going, that's seven things. It's going to be talking forever. No, it won't be forever. It won't be forever. Don't worry. Eternity with God is forever. This won't be. But let's just look at this. Let's begin with the promise of Jesus Christ's death. And this goes, of course, way back to the first two people on earth and their first involvement with sin. As soon as they needed a Savior, death was promised. Christ's death was promised. Let's give your Bible some exercise today, and let's read this initial promise. It's right there near the beginning of your Bible, Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. You got a paper version, you got an electronic version. Go ahead and open that up. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, and God here is talking to Satan, but Adam and Eve are right there listening in, and so the promise is really for them. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, this is where it starts. And God says to Satan, and I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. So Jesus was going to be born as one of the offspring or the descendants of that first couple, but it's saying that he was born to die. That's what God meant when he said that Satan would strike Christ's heel. It was a promise that Jesus would come and die, and yet notice that it also says that he will crush Satan's head. Ironically, in dying, Jesus would actually destroy Satan and the works of sin. His death would actually be a victory. Pretty cool. So the promise of a Savior to die in our place, it's nothing new. It wasn't a last-minute decision. It wasn't a last-ditch effort. For as long as humanity needed it, the promise was there to give us hope and courage. All right, so let's next consider the prophecy of Christ's death. All right, it's going to come in a moment, I think. We've lost our connection. The prophecy of Christ's death. Along with the promise that our Savior would come to die in our place, God also inspired some of the Bible writers to open up kind of a window on some of the details of that death. And these prophecies reveal that in dying for our sins, Jesus was going to suffer. It wasn't going to be easy. There's no glossy coating to this. You know, earlier we read together in our scripture reading one of those prophecies from Isaiah 53. And you listen to what it says there about this Savior who is going to come to die, and it says, he was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. He took up our infirmities. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. This prophecy is speaking of things like punishment and wounds and oppression and affliction. This isn't nice. The prophecies make it very clear that his death would not be a quick and easy death, just done. In dying for us, the Lord was going to suffer physically as well as mentally. Another prophecy highlighting this fact about the Messiah's death we find in the Psalms, in Psalm 22. And David, in writing this psalm from the perspective of his own experiences, he probably didn't realize at the time that the Holy Spirit was also guiding at least some of his words to be descriptive of the experiences surrounding the death of the promised Savior to come. But it's interesting that New Testament gospel writers, they clearly saw the connections between David's word and what they witnessed happening on Calvary. And Jesus certainly identified with the words of this psalm when he suffered. In fact, you may recall, Matthew and Mark record that while he was hanging, dying on the cross, what did Jesus say? "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And where does that come from? Interestingly enough, those are the very first words of Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? You know what? There are people, there's lots of stories of people who have died saving others throughout Earth's history, right? And there are even people who have chosen to die in the place of someone else. There's lots of examples of that. And those are very honorable decisions that someone makes when confronted with a specific situation to say, no, instead of you dying, I'll die in your place. That's pretty amazing. But imagine if those people could have known all of their lives that they were coming to that situation. How would they cope throughout their life knowing that their life was heading to that point where they were going to lose their life for someone else? How would you like to know that in advance? You know, I tried to think if there were maybe other people who were specifically born to die, and I only came up with a couple of possibilities. Maybe you can think of some others I didn't think of. But I was thinking, you know, in different times and places, hopefully times in the past, there have been people who believed in this idea of offering human sacrifices to their God, and that usually included the practice of sacrificing their children. So I suppose in those times, it's possible that in those situations, some children were given life merely for the purpose of being available as a sacrifice to some God. Kind of gruesome to think of. And then I also thought of the abhorrent possibility that there may be people, and in fact there are people, who are willing to produce or acquire babies for the sake of selling their body parts, right? Kids that are just born to be inventory on the black market underground. So it's a grim reality of our world. But in both of those situations, the person who is born to die certainly doesn't have any choice or any say in the matter. And certainly, I think if they could know their fate beforehand, and if they could have a say in that, I'm pretty sure they would surely choose not to be born in the first place if they're just being born to die. What is so remarkable, what is so astounding about Jesus is that he knew way beforehand that he would only be born to die. 1 Peter 1:20 says that the decision was made before the creation of the world. He knew how much he would suffer. He knew how few people for whom he would die could care less or appreciate it. He knew that in advance. And he did have a say in the matter, but he went ahead. Like the song that Sandy sang said, he went ahead and chose to walk that road. He chose to be born just to die for you and me. That's amazing. Hey, church, that's amazing. Yeah, I suppose it is, Pastor Godsoe. Yeah, pretty good. Come on, man. That's a choice that was made by Jesus while he was still in his divine form as one member of the eternal Godhead. But then he was born into this world as a human being. And from a young age, he understood who he was. He understood what his mission was. He realized that he had been born to die, and he realized that he was going to suffer in the process. And he still had a say in it. He could have just called the whole thing off, but he didn't. He chose to die in our place. What a God. That brings us to the pain of his death. Certainly the physical pain was severe. I mean, think about what happened. He had no sleep. He was whipped unmercifully. He was beaten up. He was tortured with thorns rammed into his head. And then in that weak and exhausted state, his physical strength was pressed far beyond all limits, and he was forced to try to carry the cross to the place of execution. And that was the easy part, right? To be nailed to a cross, to be hung up to die, was the most painful, the most drawn-out way that the Romans could come up with to kill who they considered to be a worthless person. It was designed to get the maximum return of suffering from its victim. It wasn't, we're just going to kill you. We are going to kill you as badly as we can. But as great as the physical pain was, that wasn't all. There was the emotional pain, the separation from his family, from his friends, from his followers. And for someone who loved people so fully, how can we know what that separation meant to him? So yes, others have endured the physical pain of crucifixion. Thousands of people were crucified. Jesus wasn't the only person to ever experience that. But for Jesus, there was so much more. His relatively quick death on the cross reveals that perhaps the mental, the emotional, the spiritual pain, maybe that was even more anguishing to him than the severe physical pain that he experienced. But the truth is, you know, there are people every year who have them, especially this time of the year, right? Usually on Good Friday in certain parts of the world, there are people who have themselves nailed to a cross, right? You know that? Every year. They carry a cross, and then they have themselves nailed, and they hang there for a while. I expect it hurts a lot. And in doing so, they think that they're experiencing what Christ went through. And while their intentions may be honorable, may be good, I mean, come on, that's really a mockery to Christ's death. It's a mockery. Because there's really no way that we can measure the pain that Jesus endured. Try to imagine this. Try to imagine what it would be like, if you can. Imagine that you had never, ever been forgiven
for a single thing that you had ever done wrong. You had never in your life been forgiven for any mistake that you ever made. You know, you were never forgiven by a parent, never forgiven by a spouse, never forgiven by a friend, by a coworker, never forgiven by a teacher, never forgiven by God for a single thing that you've ever done. Imagine that. I mean, how rotten and miserable would you feel to never experience forgiveness from anyone? Talk about a crushing and immobilizing load of guilt to try to shoulder. I can't imagine what that would be like. Thankfully, I have been forgiven by God and lots of people. So I don't know, but how could I, if that is the case, that I can't even imagine that, how could I begin to imagine what it would be like to feel the shame and the condemnation and to feel the remorse of all of the sins and all of the mistakes of every human being to ever exist? What in the world does that feel like? What a staggering press of guilt to bear. I can go hang on a cross, but I don't know what Jesus experienced. I love how Max Lucado's descriptive way of describing this in the book, he did this just for you. He writes, Jesus stood silent as a million guilty verdicts echoed in the tribunal of heaven, and the giver of light was left in the chill of a sinner's night. He's describing the pain of facing an eternity of undeserved separation from God. That's what Jesus did for us. All right, let's move now to the from the pain to the place of Christ's death. And the truth is, we can't for certain pinpoint where the exact place of Christ's crucifixion would be today. There's people that try to claim it's here or there. But we can look at what the Bible says. So take your Bible, and let's read what Luke 23, verse 33 has to say, because it does tell us where this took place. Luke chapter 23, verse 33. We maybe don't know exactly where this is today, but we know where it was back then. Luke 23, verse 33 says, when they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus died in a place called the Skull, or the place of a skull. Kind of sounds like a pleasant place for a picnic, right? Place of a skull. Let's go there. No. And you know, the names that we know this place by, they come from the words for skull in other languages. So we call the place Golgotha. That's the Hebrew or Aramaic word for skull. Or we call it Calvary, and that is the Latin word for skull. It's talking about the same place. It was a small hill of execution somewhere outside the city walls of Jerusalem. That's what it was. I mean, think about it. If Jesus was going to come as our Savior and die for our sins, shouldn't it have been, if he's going to do that in a place of honor and dignity, shouldn't it have been surrounded with grateful, respectful, adoring worship? But even though he was judged by the authorities to be innocent, those who killed him tried to make him look as guilty as possible, as guilty as possible. I mean, he was shamefully tortured and abused. He was taunted. He was mocked. He was shown the disgrace of dying with other worthless criminals in the place of the skull. The cross was the place most lacking in honor. This was a public, pitiable, pathetic and putrid place. No glory there. But who was the person who died in this place? There it is. To outward appearance, he was a loser and he was powerless. He seemed to be alone. He seemed to be without support. And yet through it all, he somehow maintained this uncanny and compelling sinless integrity and bearing. Somehow, you know, Pilate had a sign attached to his cross identifying him as the King of the Jews, but oh man, he was so much more than that. So much more. He was the Savior. He was God in human flesh, and he was a king not just of the Jews, but King of the universe. Revelation 19:16 calls him the King of kings and Lord of lords. Revelation 20 tells us that he's also the ultimate judge, which means that eventually everyone will face Jesus in this role of judge. Those who've accepted him as king and those who have rejected or mocked or ignored him as king, we all meet him as our judge and king. The person at the cross? How about the power in Christ's death? And the power, I would say, was in his perseverance, because he went right through to the finish. Look at what it says in John 19, verse 30. John chapter 19, verse 30 assures us with what Jesus said here. John 19, verse 30, describing him hanging on that cross, it says, when he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Those were very important and powerful words. It is finished. It didn't just mean that his earthly life was finished. He meant that the price had been paid. The provision for salvation was now permanent. This was a powerful knockout punch to Satan. This is where it was like settled. Listen to Ellen White explains the power in Christ's death. She wrote, "Christ on the cross has satisfied justice. He's proffered himself as an atonement. His gushing blood, his broken body, satisfy the claims of the broken law, and thus he bridges the gulf which sin has made. He suffered in the flesh that with his bruised and broken body he might cover the defenseless sinner." You might relate to that person. "The victory gained at his death on Calvary broke forever the accusing power of Satan over the universe and silenced his charges that self-denial was impossible with God and therefore not essential in the human family." 7 Bible Commentary 974. Talk about power. There's power in that death. But finally, let's consider briefly the pardon in Christ's death. There it is. The pardon. And to do that, let's go to a familiar Bible verse. Let's go to 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. Many of you know that well. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. We started near the front of the Bible, and we've made our way to near the back of the Bible. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. Find that with me, and it says these wonderful words: "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness." And then if we just slide back up, move back up to verse 7, it says, "But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from every sin." The death of Jesus provides us with forgiveness for all sin, every sin. And Pradama, you read a quote from The Desire of Ages at the beginning that talked about that, how Jesus was buying the right to be our mediator, right? I think that's what it said. Might have to review it. But that's what he was doing on the cross. Yeah, he was providing for our forgiveness. He was providing for our pardon. Romans 3:23 reminds us that we're all born as sinners, and thus, in that sense, you know what? We're all born to eventually die. Romans 6:23 affirms that the wages of sin is death. We can only pay for our sins by being punished with the eternal loss of our lives. That's how you pay for it. But Jesus Christ suffered for us, and as it says in Psalm 103, verse 3, he forgives all my sins. Hallelujah. He forgives all my sins. And let's not forget the potent words of John 3:16, right? "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but instead have eternal life." We need to believe this with our minds and our hearts. We do. The death of Christ is in vain unless we accept his pardon. The pardon in Christ's death is highlighted center stage in the pronouncement that Jesus made to that repentant thief who was strung up beside him. It's recorded in Luke 23. The thief asked Jesus to remember him when Jesus came into his kingdom, and right then and there, Jesus forgave that man, that thief, and he promised him paradise. Pardon. That's what his death is all about. Pardon. That's why he wanted to be our advocate, so that he could bring about our pardon. And you see, here's where Christ's death gets very real and practical for us individually. Because here's the thing, we can know all about the death of Jesus, right? I mean, we can know about the promise. We can know about the prophecy of his death. We can understand that stuff, read it in the Bible. And you can have an awareness of the pain of his death. You can read about that and think about that. And you can understand the place of his death. And you can look into the person who died. We can even know all about the power in his death. But here's the thing. Until you personally accept the pardon in his death, really it's pointless. All the other P's are pointless. Until you accept and understand the pardon, it's of no lasting good or relevance unless you take the pardon. Jesus finished making the provision for salvation, but he's not finished with us. He's not finished offering to you and me the pardon that he died so that we could have. And that's the good news about why he continues to do what he's been doing as our Savior since he popped back out of the grave fully alive. Amen? He was born to die. He was born to die for you. And thank God he was born to die for me. And he was born to die so that he could offer to us pardon. And so I simply want to say to you today, take it. Take it, please. Take it. And as we sing our closing song, our deacons are going to hand out to you a little piece of paper. It has a little cross on it, kind of matches the one up here. And it just says the word pardon. Because I'd like you to take this and think about the pardon that God gives you. Maybe, you know, put it on your fridge or in your car or by your bed or in your Bible or do whatever you want with it. Write a little note to God on the back, a little prayer to God, thanking him for his pardon. Something physical to remind you this weekend when we think about it. But that's why Jesus died, so that you could have pardon. And so as we sing our closing song, you get one of these pieces of paper. I hope that you'll think about that today and maybe remind yourself of that going forward. I also want to remind you before we sing that we do something called 7 minutes or less. If you're visiting our church today, if you're not a regular person who's here, we're inviting you to come up right at the end of the service, right to the front here. And our welcome team just wants to take 7 minutes or less just to greet you, give you a little gift. Just give you a special welcome to joining us in worship here at College Park today. So let's stand together. Let's sing about this cross that Jesus died on so that we could have pardon.
When I see you fade, no one describes.
Dear Lord, I don't know what else I can say, but simply thank you for dying for us, for living for us, and then dying for us, and living again for us, so that we can have your gift of pardon, and we can have eternity with you. Thank you for what you've done for us. Amen.